Everybody, it is Record Time with Chris, number 16. And as you can see, we have a special guest today, Spencer Albee, the main musician who has, of course, played all over the U.S. in bands, his old bands, Rustic Overtones and As Fast As. He's sort of in the power pop world right now, and he's going to be here a little bit later to show off the vinyl package of the new album that he's releasing on Tuesday. So looking forward to that. I've seen photos. It looks really, really cool. And he can explain what the heck the thing on the cover is. And we may talk about some other things. And maybe, I bet you he's going to wear this t-shirt. I wore it today because I think he's going to wear it. Now, before we get into Spencer, no discussion topic today because Spencer's the discussion topic. I do want to update you on some of the things that are going on in the indie vinyl world. Some of the hot pre-orders that are going on right now. One of them that's about a week old is the new Halsey album. And for people who pre-order this at indie stores, they're going to get this 7-inch. Every indie store, they're independent, so they're going to do it however they do it there. But check with your store. And it's black vinyl, but you got this green thing there. There are two different colors. Of course, there's CD and probably digital, I assume. There's an indie version, which is red and yellow splatter. I forget the pressing size on that. And just for any store, there's clear with heavy teal. So if you're a big fan, I guess you could get this and both colorways. That's it's great to have this already, even though it's a June 2nd release. There is a large amount of indie exclusives in the metal world right now. We're seeing a ton of them from Nuclear Blast in particular. It seems like their game plan for 2017 is to have multiple colorways of each record, and so the wide retail version is colored. They seem to like to do splatters, and then they're going to do a different splatter for the indies. All the ones that I can think of are limited to 300 copies at the indies, and the wide release is just limited to probably whatever they think they can reasonably press and sell right now. It wouldn't surprise me if the Nuclear Blast website had some other colorways as well. But let me hit you with some of the ones that there are. So there's two different Municipal Waste albums. Again, there's like a new one and a reissue. Decapitated has one. There's two Danzig albums, a reissue and a new one. The indie version of Skeletons by Danzig has sold out on the distributor side. So if you were thinking of pre-ordering it, you should do it ASAP. And if you actually, you might not even get it then. It depends how things go. Origin was just announced Friday. They're another Nuclear Blast band, and the same thing. Did I say Nuclear Glass? Nuclear Blast. I mentioned the other Municipal Waste. Yeah, so that's cool. There's also the soundtrack to A Scanner Darkly. Like, it's like an electronic soundtrack. There's a green with black splatter for that. Haim, oh yeah, Haim was just announced yesterday, and that's just a regular pre-order, but people seem to be all over that. Chris Robinson, Brotherhood, it's another one. The new studio album that people are really excited about, that even though the live album, Betty's Blends Volume 3, just came out. So if you haven't picked that up yet, maybe think about pre-ordering the new studio album when you're in there. There's also, Japandroids. People have been asking about that all week long. Japandroids have a 7-inch, but it's exclusive to their website, or maybe it's the label's website. Anyway, we won't have it. So that's where you got to look for that. There's three different Tim Buckley titles that are being reissued on vinyl. Tim Buckley, Jeff Buckley's dad, and he's got like a similar voice, but the production is more like late 60s, early 70s production. It was a big deal back then. Two different labels, in fact, bringing us those, but that's pretty cool. A lot of David Bowie going on. There is the Picture 7-inch, which is part of the series that he's been doing a lot of. Well, Parlophone have been doing. I think this one is from like one of the Eno albums, I'm not sure. They also just announced gold vinyl of Hunky Dory and The Rise and Fall of Ziggy Stardust. We've been getting so many pre-orders for those. I think we're going to have to cut ours off soon. And so if you're interested, wherever you like to buy your records, I would definitely pre-order those. And they also just announced that the CD of the live double album that was released for this past Record Store Day that sold out immediately, there's a CD of that. So at least you can pick up the CD if you missed the vinyl. And, oh, speaking of which, Legacy's like five windowed titles from Record Store Day are also being released now on black vinyl. The pre-orders for those just went up, and that's like the Dave Matthews box set, the Springsteen, Coheed and Cambria, and I don't remember what the other two are. I think there's five. So, but anyway, you can find those out. Oh, Music on Vinyl has announced Catherine Wheel Ferment. That's, I think, red. I forget what color, but that's another one that people are really excited about right now. That's what's going on there. And I want to show you one more thing. This Ayreon, I guess that's how you pronounce it, album came out about a week ago. And there's like a regular, this is, they're prog metal band. So you know, like a lot of prog metal bands, they have the regular CD. They've got the deluxe CD, which I'll tell you about in a second, and vinyl, of course. So the artwork, as you can, is really great. And there is a long booklet in the regular CD, but in the deluxe version that has extra DVD in it, there are, well, here, I should show you the picture. So it's this nice. It's actually like a two CD long rock opera with guest stars singing all the different parts, which Ayreon, Lucas, what's his name? I forget his name. Anyway, he's awesome. He writes all the stuff and plays a bunch of the instruments. But like he likes to do, he's done a couple of these. The regular CD version is lacking these schematic diagrams in the back. Now, if you have a home theater system with center and rear channels, if you could do 5.1 at your house and you like prog metal, I would definitely go for this version, because the DVD has the album in high resolution stereo, so better quality than this. Also, there's a surround sound mix, and this is a very dense and really wonderfully layered, well thought out album. So there's all this stuff going on, and it's great to have it spread around you. You can really, it's a really immersive experience. The cool thing about the vinyl, though, is that, well, the lyrics are probably at a size you can read. So you know, there is a story. The singers, I mean, these are all like metal singers, but they're not of the, like, did I show you the Suffocation record? Oh, I never did. Oh, crap. Oh, yeah. Well, they're not like, say, Suffocation, where, you know, it's all the, I'll show you this in a second because it looks really cool. They're more of the, like, Dio or Sebastian Bach kind of operatic style singers, so it's really clear. I think, you know, the guy from Dream Theater, I think, is on this playing one of the parts. So anyway, you don't necessarily need the lyrics, but it might help you follow the story a little bit, and you can probably read them better in the vinyl version, which I don't have here. So back to metal, regular metal. This is death metal band, Suffocation, and obviously I have this here. I just listened to side one, and let me tell you, this is relentless. It just pounds you from beginning to end. So if that is your thing, you're gonna enjoy this. Now, let me show you what the vinyl looks like. This is electric blue with black splatter, and this is part of that nuclear blast program I talked to you about. 300 copies available at the indie stores, but there's also a regular version that is electric blue vinyl. And now this electric blue is actually kind of translucent, so it looks really cool when you have it. We've got really good artwork, obviously, the blue and black theme, very strong on the whole thing. And we've got lyrics, which are good because it's very hard to understand the singer. And a lot of thank yous and all that stuff. Good liner notes. Okay, now we're just going to wait for Spencer.
Oh, good, yeah.
The Eminem promo sticker from 1999.
Yeah, that drops. Get ready for this. It's going to be a big hit. Drops in 2/23/1999.
Yeah. They probably told me he's kind of like Vanilla Ice, but he swears.
Oh man. Well, at least he outlived that legacy. He created his own.
He did, yeah. So let's look at the record.
Let's look at it.
Okay. So it's coming out Tuesday.
Tuesday.
And, you know, we've actually already shipped all the pre-orders, so people who bought it online will get it Tuesday.
Awesome.
So that was the
point.
That's
great.
That's why.
Thanks for doing that.
Yeah, well, you know, you brought it in early. So I see the Rolling Stone quote.
Yeah.
Was that from the Beatles night?
No, that was was named, an EP I put out a couple of years ago was named one of the 15 best records you never heard.
Oh!
Of the year. Whatever year that was, 16, 15. So, but that was a quote from that, and I figured,
nice.
Well, you know, I have a quote from Rolling Stone, so I might as well.
Yeah, the 20th studio, wow.
20. Ish. I actually went through with somebody called to attention that because I put that, little EP out for Record Store Day, is this now 21?
21.
And I was like, eh, whatever.
But didn't you like produce a Jeremiah Freed album or something? Or
oh,
like
I used
Head
to have,
Start or whatever?
Yep. Yes to both. 6 gig. Amy Allen, P. Kilpatrick.
You didn't count those.
Jenny Paquette. No, those are productions for other people. So I guess I technically could. Maybe this is more like 30.
Wow.
That doesn't make me any younger, the more that number grows.
I was thinking earlier that of the like professional musicians in Maine, you and the only person I think I've seen more often than you is over the years is the Portland Symphony Orchestra.
Oh, wow.
Maybe I've seen them more. I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
So it's between, you know, Rustic, Overtones, and
right.
As Fast As and everything, and Beatles Night. So, wow, this is cool. So what do you think? How does the back of the record look? Good?
It's pretty subtle.
I'm going to scooch up so we can show it. So what is that cover image? It's kind of, is that like from a,
go
what
ahead.
Is that? From a, the Invisible Man?
It was from my eye doctor. And I was sitting in the chair, and she left the room, and it's one of those things you can take apart and see all the different parts of the eye, so you can point it with a pencil and tell you how expensive it's going to be to fix it. That kind
with
of
a pencil.
With a pencil. And all of a sudden, she turned off the overhead lights and turned on these lights that just everything looked amazing in it. You know, everyone looked 20. It was just like soft and great. And I looked over and there was this eyeball looking at me. So I just picked it up and took a picture. I took the cover photo with my iPhone, which is going to really aggravate anybody who's a photographer. but I did, and it looks good, and I don't care.
Looking at the inside.
Yeah, you know, get the inside. You got the Gemini. No, I'm sorry, the Voyager.
Oh, is
Carl
that
Sagan. Yeah.
I thought it was the Bull Moose bag.
Yeah, somebody else had mentioned that. Yeah.
Oh, that's really?
Yeah.
That's cool. I like that.
It's kind of similar, I suppose.
Is there a booklet in here, or is this where the poster is?
That's where the poster
is.
Yeah, go ahead.
Signed? These are all signed?
Yeah, every one of them. So this run is one of 300. Chris here has number 10 because of friendship.
Ah, cool. Oh, thank you. You know, I ended up with number one of your Record Store Day thing. I just pulled
you did?
I just pulled it off a thing, yeah.
No kidding.
Yeah. But there's this kid that my son sort of knows who was asking me how your in-store went. He's like 14. So
yeah, yeah.
I just thought, well, I should give it to him.
Well, that's nice.
I didn't, though, because I realized it after he was gone.
Well, then good. Then it's a win-win. Plus, yeah, you can call me or whatever. You know.
Oh, yeah, that's true. So here's the poster.
Zingy Zoo.
Yeah. And you got the Nimoy thing. Oh, which reminds me, so the Star Trek thing. Do you want to have some of that Earl Grey?
Oh, I'd love some Earl Grey.
Go ahead. It should be ready. Yeah, I just...
You in a strainer already?
Yeah, just pour it. Oh, I forgot the half and half.
That's okay.
Okay. So we got the... is there anything we should know about the poster? Well, let's look at the...
Well, the back of the poster is all the information. So I went... Normally on a CD or something, you don't really have that much room. And certainly like... If you're doing just a digital release or whatever, you don't, you know, you can put the information somewhere, but who's going to read it? Do you want this now, or?
Yeah. Thanks.
Thank you.
So.
Nice.
Mm-hmm. Sony's got this whole thing they're doing right now, and it's sort of, cheers, yeah. sort of related. They're trying to get people, just try to explain to people why records are fun.
Yeah, I got into a spirited debate with a colleague of mine over it, and I think that he was under the understanding that I was arguing that vinyl was the future of music.
Mm-hmm.
And then it kind of got into like the whole, like, and what I was trying to impress, and I think I eventually made my point and cooled the waters. But I was saying that it's like, it is a it's a part of the story, and as an independent artist, to be able to make something, to be able to put my music on a medium that excites people, that they'll go buy.
Sure,
I think it's great. I like vinyl. Mm-hmm. So here's how I live my life. I don't really have a CD player so much anymore. I have my Blu-ray player.
Yeah.
Or a car. I might have them in the car.
Yeah, me too.
But otherwise, I do online subscription, and then I buy vinyl. So, like, I was very pleased a couple weeks ago. I was at Scarborough, and I was able to buy two new releases on vinyl from bands that I kind of follow. You know, so it's kind of nice to be kind of caught up in my vinyl buying and be able to be part of the story currently. And, you know, not just like Spoon and like The Shins, which I did buy that on vinyl too, but like these are like maybe like lesser known bands are still either, I don't know if they're on their way out, but they're just kind of hovering underneath.
Do you want to say who they are?
Well, one's Timber Tambor, and the other one was the Fruit Bats, the new Fruit Bats record, which I really love that new Fruit Bats record.
Wow.
And I'm looking for their last record on vinyl. I can go down to Portland.
I was just looking it up.
I have a Portland number saved in my phone.
Do you?
Yeah, of course. I call them.
All the time?
Yeah.
So the thing about it is I can read the lyrics.
Yes, and so, yeah, as I was saying, now we have all this room, so I was able to put in all the information, certainly who was involved in it, which wasn't a ton of room or taken up there because I recorded it
at home. It's Steve.
Recorded it and mixed it at home. Uh-huh. Carlin helped me produce it, and Carlin helped me mix it.
Uh-huh.
And Steve mastered it.
Yeah.
And then I did the layout. And then we have a couple of guests.
Mm-hmm. And the sax, yeah.
Yeah, a couple of co-writers here and there. One being Carl and the other one being Oscar Romero of Endless Jags and many other projects. Very talented guy, very good dude.
Cool. Oh, and that's the one song with bass.
I just said that and I just felt like I sounded like the president. It grossed me out. Good guy. Good man. You know, but that is how I feel about him.
You know, I see here that you have, that he plays bass. Oscar Romero gets on bass, and one of the things I noticed about it is you use synth bass almost all the way through.
Yeah, just about.
Is there like just one song on side two with there's the fuzz bass.
Yeah, the fuzz bass appears on two or three songs.
Yep.
Double tracked, panned hard left and right, so it's really
big. It's nice.
It's neat, yeah.
I really like the fourth song that has that.
The fourth song.
It's like a galloping kind of rhythm.
That's called instrumental breakdown.
Okay.
It's called instrumental breakdown.
I get it. Yeah.
Yeah. Track two has that big mushy bass.
It is "Call Me Up When You Want Blood."
Yeah. That is what I say.
That's it. Because I was like, most people would say "love" here, but no, this is a typical Spencer, like, kind of. Yeah, but I think there was one. There's one song on here that is like happy about love, isn't there?
Oh yeah, there's a bunch of that. It's all in there. "Miss You Too." It's kind of, well, it's a little bit melancholy, but...
Melancholy's okay. Oh, that's the ballad?
No, that's too much, and that has live bass on it. I played real bass on that.
Okay,
well.
Yep.
It just depended on the moment, the motion of the song, but yeah, you're right, for the lion's share of the record, it's synthesizer bass.
Uh-huh.
It's all programmed drums, which is a personal challenge of mine to make a record with synthesized drums.
I didn't pick up on that.
Good. Because I didn't want to make it with synthesized drums and have people go like, those are fake drums. I just wanted it to be part of the story, you know, part of the mix, and just fill its role. And
yeah,
and then when we play it live, obviously we have, and actually Andrew Hodgkins from As Fast As is back.
Oh really?
Yep, so I get to play with him again, which
is
so
great. He is a great drummer.
Oh my god.
And obviously he knows what to do with your songs.
He does what, it's him and McCray Hathaway on bass.
Oh, but he's been with you for a long time.
Yeah, a few years now. And then Blythe Armitage, who's also been with me for a while, singing. Renee Coolbrith, who is new to my world, but a friend.
She's
great. Scott Moeller from Dominic and the Lucid is on keys and guitar, and everybody sings. So we're a 6-piece that sounds like a 12 sometimes.
Wow.
And we practiced initially just as acoustically in my house. No amplification, really. After a while, Scott played a little electric guitar amp just to kind of start integrating effects and stuff like that. But we broke the songs down to their very, you know, the foundation, and learned them, you know, from there. And then we took it to the practice space.
Oh, cool.
So, and now we're at the point where we played them so many times and have been playing shows, like, kind of secretly here and there, just to kind of get the bugs out. And everyone is now, they know the songs, but they're playing the songs themselves. Like, they have their own voice, they're playing the parts themselves, because we know... they know what the song is going for, you know?
Oh, cool.
But the really cool thing is that because of the way we rehearsed it up, now when we play an acoustic show, it's not just like with acoustic guitars, it's kind of great. I enjoy listening to it.
Good.
The band, you know?
Oh, that's
cool. And then I get to also play along, which is extra fun, as you can imagine.
Yeah, I always thought that the mark of a good band was that they could do their music acoustic and still put it across. It might sound totally different. Mm-hmm. I mean, that might not be true of like a death metal band, but somebody...
You raise a good point. We, as fast as get caught on tour, when the album came out on Octone,
mm-hmm.
they kind of decided that the song Florida Sunshine was the single, which
yeah.
I didn't personally agree with. But then we had to go around to all these various, you know, Bull Mooses around America and mm-hmm. radio stations and playing their conference rooms for the staff and stuff. And
yeah.
everywhere, here's the focus song, which was this kind of like rave up rocker. Mm-hmm. It just sounded like a 1974 rock jam or 77.
Yeah. It was perfect. It was in that TV show, Florida,
CSI
whatever.
Miami.
Yeah, but I mean, it was what that was. Yeah, and that's,
It's fine. It's fine, but I just wouldn't have chosen it as a single mm-hmm. to me. It lacked the gravitas. It was neither to me so openly, abrasively catchy enough to be a pop single. Not that I don't pride myself on making openly, abrasively catchy things, but I'm sure there's some people who disagree. But it also wasn't substantial enough. And when we put it together, it wasn't about being substantial. You know, the lyrics, I think, do have meaning, but the song itself was just about just rocking out, you know?
Yeah.
And all of a sudden it was the focus track. I'm just like, no, any other song on the record would have been a better single for me.
Yeah.
But yeah, but that was a really hard tune to play acoustic. And so...
at probably 8 o'clock in the morning after
sometimes,
all night.
Oh yeah, sometimes. Actually,
yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. All right, definitely have seen... that they don't do that to bands anymore as
good.
Much because the budget's not there.
Good.
But... you know, I saw Alter Bridge on a tour, a cruise ship in San Diego, just going around, you know, we had dinner.
Yeah.
And there was only one person on the boat who liked Creed, but he didn't realize that Alter Bridge was 3/4 of Creed.
Oh,
so,
neither did I.
Or him. Oh, yeah, it's just without the singer.
Huh.
But I think the guitar player, who's really good, wrote the songs, but they didn't get as big because, you know.
So kind of like Stone Temple Pilots when they did Talk Show. Except instead of Stone Temple Pilots, it's Creed.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right. Yeah.
I'll reserve.
I don't know.
Qualifying that statement.
The guitar player was so good that it worked.
Mm-hmm.
Even though he was playing acoustic, because he's
just great guitar player.
He's just great. Like way better than people would give him credit for.
Mm. Yeah, I never got past the step.
Yeah, you gotta go through the second step.
You gotta take the next step.
Yeah.
I got a step infection. Just listening to it.
So, all right, black vinyl.
Unlike most records, this one has two sides.
Oh!
Yeah, some people skip out and only give you one, or sometimes
mm-hmm.
three, but this one has two.
And I think we got a CD in here.
A little, this is the only time my last name has come in handy.
A, B. A L B. Wow. Hey, that's
Isn't that clever?
That is. Yeah. So you threw in the CD also. And
yeah.
This is cool. I don't know if anybody has ever done the CD and the download. Wait, that's a sticker.
That's a sticker. Download cards on the other side.
Sticker of the void. Yeah, here we go. So download code. And it has got a groove. That's
cool.
Good. Yeah.
I went through Crooked Cove. They brokered it or whatever.
Yeah. They do half of the local bands or the ones that Sal go through.
Every record I've done myself, with the exception of Something Fierce, we did through Crooked Cove. That one was through Super Dupes for some reason.
Huh.
And maybe I've done more through Super Dupes. But, I mean, Crooked Cove since 95, so.
Awesome.
I kind of figured if they can do vinyl, like, why not stay with them? Yeah.
Yeah. This company got a groove that they used. They have all their plating and the cutting is all in-house.
Oh, good.
So.
That's smart, too.
Sure, yeah. That'd be awesome. So I think they just know each other, and they're maybe only 5 years old, but they're getting a good reputation for, doing a good job.
We might get some.
That's okay. It's probably just rust.
Oh, good.
Or the.
As long as it's not tea leaves. As long as you can get.
I'll tell your fortune later.
Yeah.
I think this album will sell.
Or you'll get lockjaw.
Yeah. So now, Relentlessly Yours, that's a, I guess that's the nice love song thing, is that what that is, like dedication, because you just...
It's just funny, I mean, there's a lot of humor, like, laced throughout it, I mean, it's like...
All is quiet on the Western Prom.
Literary, in my great tradition of literary references.
Yeah, but that song is so rooted in Portland, though.
Oh, 100%. It's literally about walking from the Western Prom to the Eastern Prom.
Right.
One morning as the sun came up.
Those are neighborhoods in Portland.
Yeah, Maine. So, and so I was walking towards the sunrise and stopped, in the second verse, we're in a coffee shop because I was. There's a lot of jokes and a lot of, like, I tried to, like, just let it really speak to my... personality, so there's darkness in there. When I was writing this record, I was certainly going through a really hard breakup.
Oh.
Yeah. And then, but also, as I am wont to do, I kind of portray that in a humorous way. If track five were an instrumental, you'd think it was just about lollipops. Or like daiquiris on a beach. My friend and co-producer Carlin called. She said I invented a type of music which is hipster tropical.
Hipster tropical. Oh, no.
Which is fine.
Wow.
I'll take it.
Okay, good. So, tell me about the. So in hip hop.
Yeah.
There are a lot of people talk about the clock, but you're more. You have like glockenspiel on.
Yeah, I play glock a lot. I don't think ever killed anybody with one.
No, is that just the Brian Wilson thing?
I don't know. I love how I bought one in 2005. When I was out in Oregon when I lived out there. I bought one at a music shop. And I just loved how it's just this neat little, being of the synthesizer variety. You're always looking for that sound that just like maybe it just provides a little accent but stays out of the way of other things, Glockenspiel.
Oh, it hasn't like no sustain. Yeah, it's just a little thing. Yeah.
I mean, it has sustain, but it just kind of gets buried and it lives in this singular little spot. And I also like it how it can make things sound a little fragile, a little magical, like kind of icy. You can kind of like almost like if you wanted to like make the sound of falling snow, I think the Glockenspiel would probably be good. Like Dance of the Sugar Plum Fairies kind of thing.
That's a Celeste.
Yeah, but still the same bell.
Idea, right.
That vibe.
That's cool.
Do you know Robin Canner?
Yeah.
There's a running gag between us. Robin's a designer.
Yeah.
And they went through a phase of where there are circles you know.
Like her designs were all circles?
Right.
Okay.
Integrated, there's just a lot of circles.
All right.
Right. And so I picked up on it and like sent like either text like, you know, oh, I wonder if this is a Robin Canter. You know,
screenshot. Oh, because it, yeah, yeah. Was it?
And, yeah, and she's like, oh, I wonder if you're going to put Glockenspiel on your next song. Yeah. With certainty.
Well, people do have their trademarks, yeah.
I fell into a box of percussion when I made the School Spirit Mafia record, and I just never really got away from it. The Jingle Bells and the...
Yeah.
I have my secret weapon tambourine, which is just awesome. And, yeah, so this record is, if you take all the stuff off the top and you just have the drums and bass, as we discussed, mm-hmm. it sounds kind of, it would sound like a 90s R&B record.
Interesting.
Kind of, because of the tonal quality of the synth bass and the drums.
Right.
You know, the synth drums. But then when you add on top of that 12-string acoustic guitars, ukuleles, electric guitars, out-of-tune parlor piano, and all these kind of like more traditional Americana instruments. And that's why this record, you'll notice the record, even though stylistically the songs move around, but it has a sound,
mm-hmm.
and that's why. Because you're taking, you know, perfection and putting imperfection on top of it, and a lot of it. And I recorded...
Listen for
it. Yeah. I recorded it, too, to like kind of make it like... because I record myself, mm-hmm. and by myself, and I'm not a band, but I do want to have a sense of... urgency to the music and freshness. So when I do, and I've done this for a long time, when I, like, if I record a bass part on track two, I play it all the way through.
Yeah.
Play the song. And so I do that when I sing it, like, with the exception of, like, if I screwed up a word or just sang terribly or, uh-huh. you know, coughed up a lung goblin when I was, like, singing uh-huh. or something. It's just the vocal takes are just a take. And they're loaded with imperfections, and I don't care because it's just, like, you know, how it's going to sound when I sing it, you know, live.
That's,
you know?
True. I guess
that's me. That's what I sound. I'm comfortable enough with the imperfections in my voice that it's like, whatever, you know.
Well, I didn't notice anything that came out like a mistake,
yeah.
You know, and I actually thought probably some of the things that you think are mistakes, I thought were like already like intentional. Like there are a couple places in, it's one of the songs towards the end of side one where I think it's in the chorus that starts on a high note and you kind of swoop up to it.
Yeah.
And of course it's a little different swoop every
yep.
time, but like the second time I was like, oh wait, no, that's the melody.
Right. Yeah.
Like that, it sounded
yeah,
like
I've been
that
using
was
that a lot. Kind of channeling my inner Orbison. Orbison, as Steve Jobs say. Ray Orbison.
Cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, well, yeah. Great. I mean, I just listened to it bunch of times over like,
nice.
Last night and today at work, so it, I like it. I guess the thing that struck me about it was that it seems like it's that there are pieces of a lot of different things, different phases of your career that kind of all fit in here. Like it's a very Spencer sounding album, and maybe because it's your 20th or 40th or whatever.
Yeah, I might have finally developed a sound.
Know what it is, but I mean like the synth bass, and then there's one song that starts out where the drums are, whatever, use the telephone effect or
right.
something like that, that reminds me of the drums at the beginning of Tea and Cocaine, so there's like a real...
Oh, right, yeah.
This has got more of space versus speed in it, I think, than a lot of other things. Certainly the School Spirit Mafia was a totally different sound.
Yeah, it was all acoustic-ish.
Yeah, and I always thought of that as, that's like your Rubber Soul.
Interesting, yeah.
That's what I thought of.
I personally thought of
the U.S. Rubber Soul.
The U.S. Rubber Soul? Oh, because that I've just seen a face?
Yeah. I mean, the folk rock one.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
It was. I was going for Village Green Preservation Society.
Okay.
That's just what informed me at the time. I thought I was, like, making records that sounded a certain way, and then I heard that record, and I was like, oh.
This is what I know.
I've had it all wrong.
I mean, a lot of people say that. Yeah. Wow. That's well, I guess if you're aiming for that, I mean, you could be aiming for, I don't know.
I've had songs that I've tried to make sound like Madonna.
Have you?
Yeah, they don't sound anything like Madonna.
All right, were they ever released?
Yeah, I can't remember. It was one of the songs off the Popsicle. In my mind, I was, like, trying to, like, capture that spirit and that vibe from that
really?
Track music that she had.
Wow.
And it just like, it came out sounding like nothing. What is this?
They were going to throw these out at WCLZ, their production records.
Oh, wow.
So I'll give you some of these. I have a few.
Are these like...
It's like just music beds.
News Touch.
But they're...
Touch 60, News Touch 30.
Yeah, exactly. And this one was used... See, they label them. So what does it say? Save a Buick?
Save a buck.
Save a buck.
7/22/87.
Carnival
So it
time.
Looks like they wanted to use Carnival Time for Save a Buck.
Yeah,
that's,
right.
That's the one that Buck, the owner of Save a Buck, preferred. Carnival Time.
Yep.
60. Up-tempo orchestrated.
Yeah.
Oh, this is great.
So they... and I imagine that then they didn't want to have anybody else use that, because I'm sure if you were Save a Dollar, you wouldn't want to use that like 6 months later and everybody say, oh, it's a Save a Buck thing.
These are great.
They're actually really fun. You can kind of...
great shape, too.
Yeah, they were just sitting there and they were like... Brian just thought that... if they were going to throw them out, they should just give them to me.
100%.
Yeah, and I've just been giving them out to people. Like, hey, you like records?
People who throw out vinyl... I mean, let's just like, if
like
it's
moldy
destroyed...
or something. Yeah, yeah.
But even then, you have people who... You know, I've known people who have gotten into reshaping old vinyl.
Oh, into bowls
or whatever,
and stuff.
You know,
or
coasters,
Angel with her...
Or Angel with the covers.
Yeah.
Exactly. So, like, throwing it away, I think, is, like... I mean, that's just, like, moldy and destroyed. It's kind of downright irresponsible. My neighbor... This is going to break your heart, especially. And anybody else who's a Beatles nerd out there.
Uh-huh.
My neighbor had... My mom loved the Beatles, so we had a lot of Beatles records.
Mm-hmm.
Donna Barnes had... She knows...
Your name, are you name-dropping?
Name-dropping. Donna Barnes, my neighbor and friend and, you know, mentor.
Uh-huh.
She had all first run.
Oh, really?
Just about all of it.
Uh-huh.
I mean...
Oh, she just bought it as they came out.
Yeah.
When she was a kid. Yeah.
And then they were in great shape. And so I used to, like, you know, Magical Mystery Tour with the book.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
White album with the posters on Apple.
Oh.
The whole smear. She had
She just threw them out?
Yeah, I went back when she was moving. She had me come down. She's like... you know, her family, I went to school with her daughter.
Oh.
And when they moved out of their, she and her new husband were moving to a different place, so they had some furniture, and at the time, you know, I was in my early 20s, so I got some end tables out of the deal.
Good.
And I was like, oh, what'd you do with those records? And she's like, I threw them out. And I was like, I couldn't process it. It's like finding out, like, you know, your uncle's racist or something. You know, not the same.
Oh, I know that.
Who doesn't? Yeah.
But
your old uncle racist.
He doesn't think he is.
Yeah, that's the trouble.
And I don't know. I don't think he really is. I'm just kidding. My
right.
It's cool.
The uncle that I have been thinking about was. But there you go.
Yeah. So, you know what? Sometimes I wish I had more money in the 90s when the garage salesman was selling records for a buck each, because, you know, I do remember going to... You know, like, same thing. I was in my early 20s, and I needed, like, a table. So I went to somebody's apartment sale, and I got a table. You know, a table. I needed, like, a salt shaker or something. Like, I had nothing.
Mm-hmm.
And, but then he had all these records, and I recognized a lot of them. I was like, wow, you know, and the guy, I just spent whatever I had, but... I wish I had been able to say, I'll give you $200 for the whole thing.
Because
I saw enough of the stuff to know that he had other really great stuff in there that I just, you know, like I bought one Pharoah Sanders record just because the cover looked cool. It's called Karma. I had no idea who he was.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I didn't know, just played Sun Ra and John Coltrane. I was like, I don't know what the hell this is. It looks cool. It's only $1. And there were probably, like, he probably had this amazing jazz collection that I had.
Didn't know what it was.
Hey, well, you know, the funniest thing happened. I guess that's all the interview that I got. I don't know. I guess there's a maximum time limit to a file on that camera I was using. I don't know. But we were kind of winding down at that point. So I always like the long interviews with musicians that, like, you know,
Terry Gross or Mark Maron or someone like that does, that when you really get to hear the musician's process and they just get to talk a long time, and a rock line, if you ever remember that show. So, I was glad Spencer shared that much stuff with me. I mean, I didn't know a lot of those things. And I guess if you're still watching now, you probably thought it was pretty interesting too. So maybe I'll do some more of those as I get the chance. I'll be back in a week or so. And, you know, until then, I hope you are listening to something awesome. And maybe Spencer's new album, Relentlessly Yours by Spencer Albee, will be great. Great for you. I think it's great. I've had another day with it since that interview, and yeah, it is. It's a great album. I've already got a lot of the songs burned into my head after just a couple listenings. So, hey, well, take care.